blessed to have a wonderful lady here tonight. Let's see, you have many titles. You have author, singer, missionary, let's see, marketplace missionary. It's just amazing at what God has done to you. This is Staci Wallace, and let's welcome Staci.
Thank you.
Thank
you so much for coming.
I am just in awe of your story because you are so young to have accomplished so much for the Lord to have accomplished so much through you. So if you could, I know you have a book, and we'll get to that in just a moment, but could you just tell us a little bit about your story, your background, and, and you know, I know you come from a praying family, a family of faith, of pastors, and just, and tell us about a little bit about your background, your history.
Well, I do. I come from a great heritage, and one of the things I talk about in the book is how my story began. Was the story of an overcomer. I was diagnosed with a disease called cystic fibrosis after having pneumonia over and over and over again. But I did have a praying mom and dad. And for that season of cystic fibrosis, generally a child died by the time they were 2 years old. But my mom and dad took me to the church, laid hands on me, had the elders come together. And from that day forward, I never had another form of pneumonia or cystic fibrosis in my life. It was an instantaneous, notable, documented miracle. And of course, I had to be told about that for years to come because God would go on to do incredible things with my life, with my music career. I was a country music singer and nominated for New Female Vocalist of the Year before God transitioned me after a terrible divorce and season of abuse into suicidal depression. God transitioned me out of that into being radically saved and on fire for Jesus. So I spent 15 years then using those same vocal cords and that same set of lungs that the enemy tried to kill me. Right where God was going to use me. God gave me 5.5 octaves. So I recorded 5 Christian CDs and traveled for 15 years all over the world preaching and singing and just singing about the love of Jesus, writing my own music. And then God called me into corporate America. And little did I know, I didn't think I had a dream one day that I actually saw the cover of a Time magazine that had 3 notable CEO females. This was years ago. And I thought, well, that would be fun to do. Had no idea what it would be like to be a corporate executive. God launched me into a business that ultimately put me as senior vice president of that corporation and then led us into starting a number of companies that went into the hundreds of millions. God had an anointing on my life, not only for the ministry, but also for the marketplace. And when we were at our peak of our business career, running big numbers, being big kingdom builders, giving a lot of money into the kingdom of God, God asked us to walk away from it all. And not just slightly, not when it would, you know, not because we were on down on our luck, but when we were at the top of our income earning careers. I woke up one morning at 3 o'clock and I had a song in my heart and it was, "Will you say yes? Would you sacrifice your life? Would you say yes? Would you have raised the knife? Would you say yes? Will you turn and walk away? Will you say yes to me today?" So the whole thing I was writing was about saying yes, yes, yes. And so I thought I was writing a song. But as I kept going, I realized this isn't a song. This is a request from God. My husband got up that morning and I said, "Baby, what would you do if God asked us to give everything up?" And he said, "Let me think about that for a couple weeks." And we did. We prayed about it because it meant significant change to where we were. He was also COO of a major corporation. When we walked away, we not only walked away, but we also gave up everything. We gave away our finances, gave away our money, got down to $300 in the equity in our home. And a little missionary couple came over and they said, "We've got enough to get to Denmark, but we don't have enough once we're there." And just knew God didn't want me to keep that last $300. That was 17 months ago. And I have to say that as strong as I was as a businesswoman in the marketplace, being in this place now of negotiating kingdom principles, being able to teach people how to lay hands on the sick and they recover. You know, Jesus said, "These signs and wonders will follow them that believe. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." when he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the good news, to set at liberty those who are captive. That was Jesus in his marketplace strength.
Yes.
That was him operating in the kingdom, anointed, unleashed and anointed for kingdom business. And I believe that's what God's called us to do. And so this book is all about teaching people with absolute certainty how to walk into a boardroom, into a classroom, into a grocery store, a coffee shop, and know that you are the carrier of the presence of God. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, raised me from cystic fibrosis, gave me a tenacity to operate in the marketplace, and today has given me a platform to be able to speak to ordinary men, ordinary women, and say, if I can come out of corporate America, or if I can come out of cystic fibrosis, God doesn't care what your background is.
That's right.
You might be coming out of a life of drugs or alcohol or having been molested or domestic violence. He can use anything.
Yes, he can.
And he's looking to use our stories in order to be able to change the marketplace and the people that are there.
That's wonderful. And you know, one of the things that you're touching on is so important, and I stress it all the time. You know, especially in the last, in my generation, in our day, there's so much pressure for people to be different things to different people.
Right.
You know, and I really feel more, I guess, empathetic to women than I do men, because, you know, men traditionally have always been in the workplace and all that. The pressure's not on us to look as good as it is women and all that kind of stuff. And ladies all the time, they got to help bring home the bacon and then fry the bacon, you know, and then help provide for. And as a result, a lot of times, if we're not careful, we start to think of living for God as putting on hats. You know, that's my Sunday hat thing, you know. And I'm in corporate America, you know, this day, and that's what I'm doing here. And then I'm change hat and I'm a mom at my kid's soccer game. But you touched on some. God can use us right where we're at.
That's right.
And everything is not to be something we pick up. I live for Jesus just on a day that we're going to worship the Lord, but everything we are needs to flow through our relationship with Christ.
A lot of people have an on-off switch for the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
It's on Sunday morning when they're worshiping, but they turn it off Monday through Saturday, but that's where we're supposed to be on.
That's right.
Jesus didn't come to the synagogues and the temples.
That's right.
Most of his miracles were all done in the marketplace. He was like water. He was fluid. He seeped in throughout the marketplace. And that's really why he chose the Holy Spirit to live in us, so that he could get into the business office, so that he could get into the classroom. So today, for example, my flight got canceled before I was coming here. And a lot of times you let yourself get upset about the little things that are going in your, they seem big. You know, I thought I was going to miss my flight, not be able to be here with you guys. But there was this peace inside because I knew I am the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
If he wants to shift the flight schedule,
that's
he'll do that.
That's right.
So he must have a reason for me to not be on that flight, but to be on another flight. So I had a 3-hour wait in Dallas, Texas that I wasn't supposed to have this morning. I went to Cracker Barrel and I ended up praying for my waitress.
Amen.
I asked her, I said, how can I pray for you? She said, sobriety. Right out of the bat.
Right.
I had another young man that was needing a miracle in his physical body. I don't believe that I'm looking for a move of God.
Right.
Holy Spirit living in me tells me I am a move of God, and I'm just looking. Where do you want me to go next? Which grocery store? When I'm at the grocery store, I'll just pray. God, who needs you today before I walk out of this grocery? There's always somebody.
Yes, there is.
Always somebody in need.
Yes, there
and that's
is.
What we teach with Unleashed and Anointed for Business. You know, when we put this available on Amazon, I didn't realize, because we offer it through my website and that as well, but ordinary people started picking it up because they want to know, how do I be Jesus in the marketplace?
Yes.
You mean little old me can lay hands on the sick and they recover? The answer is, if Jesus is in you, yes, you can. He said, greater works than these will you do, because I go to sit at the right hand of God the Father. I'm positioning. I talk about it. Your kingdom position has already been anchored. You seat with him in heavenly places. So instead of operating in prayer from here up, I operate and I pray as a queen in the kingdom down. That means I have a spiritual authority. I have the ability to do the things Jesus did, not because of me, but because he lives in me.
Amen.
And if we could get that practical principle, we would see the word unleashed means to be set free from bondage and released with great force. So for me, for years, my bondage was I thought I had to be somebody in corporate America. For 15 years, I was identified by my title. Mm-hmm. I was identified by my how many commas I had in my salary or in my income trajectory. When I began to be identified by my citizenship in heaven, I realized I'm not an ambassador for corporate America. I'm an ambassador for the kingdom of God. Amen. And I can use those same negotiation skills, public speaking skills, mm-hmm. ability to sit in front of kings and queens and rulers of nations. I used to do that for corporations. Now I do it because I know they put their pants on just like I do.
Amen.
They need Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And that's one of the things that we need to be aware of.
Yes.
I can say, and I've been in pastoral ministry for 31 years, but I can tell you that personally, one-on-one, I've been able to win more people outside of when I was standing in the yeah. pulpit on Sunday than inside, because I learned, and you're kind of touching on this, mm-hmm. years ago, I learned to pray two things every day. And that is, number one, when I rise, I pray, Lord, help my life be pleasing to you today. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty simple. But then I pray, number two, Lord, make me aware of the opportunities I will have to sow into somebody's life and lead them to you. And if we'll take the blinders off mm-hmm. when we're working with somebody and they come in, they're complaining that, you know, they're in a valley or a trial, that is an open door to talk
wide
about Jesus,
open.
You know, when they're going. And I know that you're talking on that, and you have found that to be true even in corporate
in
America.
We do a Facebook Live every morning, my husband and I, because he walked away from his career as well. And we challenge people every day to text us or give us a Facebook message. What did you do today to advance the kingdom? Who
yes.
did you pray for? Who got saved? I love it. Every morning I wake up and I've got little moms that feel like they're insignificant or sweet, precious grandmas that mm-hmm. think their time is up. They're out there witnessing. They're laying hands on people. Today, a gal messaged me. She said she was at her water cooler and somebody said that they were struggling. Somebody said, kiddingly, girl, pray for me. And she said, I will pray for you. What do you need? She said, I was kidding, but I really do need prayer. Led that girl to the Lord.
Amen.
She jokingly said, pray for me. That's the way God
yes.
works. If we will be His mouth, His hands, His feet, He will take us to places that we could never go ourselves.
And He goes before us and anoints our
and
steps.
And prepares a way.
And that's what I think we get bogged down in with the embarrassing, oh, I can't go to that person. Mm-hmm. Oh, what if they reject me? Or what if mm-hmm. they don't understand the Lord is already dealing mm-hmm. with that situation.
Right before
we
I came
just
out
have
here.
To be obedient.
Exactly. Right before I came out here, I was talking to a girlfriend of mine, and she was saying, oh, Staci, my story is just, it's too. And
yeah.
I said, girl, that's exactly what God needs.
That's right.
God needs a story just like yours that's a little racy, a little saucy, but I believe that every person has a story, and
yes.
every story can change the world. If it wasn't for the stories of the Bible and the authors, we teach
right.
men and women how to write their story. We have a publishing company. We teach them how to get their story out so that they don't sit on their past. Women who've had multiple abortions and they've lived in shame, when we get that story out, now they can help others not
Correct.
Live in the shame
Correct.
Of their past. This week, our baptism, we had 2 hours worth of baptism of people that got saved on the street. They come just a hot tub, and two ladies came forward. Before they got in the water, they took off their rings. They were lesbians. They were married. They took off their rings. They said, we want to live for Jesus. We
Amen.
Know this isn't the way. Not everybody talks about that because we're supposed
That's
to
right.
be politically correct.
Right.
I don't want to be politically correct.
That's
I want to be kingdom correct.
Amen.
And I want to help people rescue them from whatever life it is
yes.
and let them know there is hope, there is peace, there is joy, and there is a better way.
Amen.
And you know what you just said is so powerful because tragically, some people in Christendom feel like that the way we're going to win the world is lower our standards to not require anything to be
it's
like them.
Love
but that's not what the Word of God says.
Right.
That salvation is free to us, but it costs more than this world could purchase.
Mm-hmm.
It's not cheap.
That's right.
And
ooh, I'm bringing out the preaching, you know.
Yeah, there we go.
You
yeah.
see his body shift.
There we go. And so you know, we need to understand that God does not sow into us and fill us with the Spirit so that we can pet people
That's
when they're
right.
in the bondage of sin.
That's right.
He fills us so that we can deliver them in
Jesus
His name.
Jesus walked up to the man, John 4, he walked up to the woman at the well. John 5, he walks up to the man at the pool of Bethesda. He didn't walk up and say, let me sympathize with how long you've been here. 38 years? Tell me that story. Mm-hmm. Oh, bless your heart. Well, I just want to relate to you. That's what we do in the kingdom a lot, is we try to relate to people. Mm-hmm. But Jesus loved them more than that.
Yes.
He loved them right where they were. He loved the harlot caught in adultery. But he loved her too much to leave her there by saying, now go and sin no more. He said to that man, you want to be well? And the man said, well, I can't because the pool is stirred and I can't get to it. Jesus said, get up, take up your mat and walk. And immediately, he didn't try to negotiate that. He walked in kingdom authority, which we talk about in this book.
Amen.
Walking in kingdom authority so that kingdom things can take place. Well, what happens with that man? He didn't say, forget your mat. He said, take it with you because your mat is your message.
That's exactly right.
And that's why we write the books we write. I know you have other guests coming on that have stories of their message, of how God has turned their mess into a message, their mat into a message. And that's what we do in the kingdom of God. Doesn't matter what your background is, God can use it.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, Staci, right quick, like, tell us about a little bit about the book, how long or when you wrote it, how long it's been published, and and some of the reasons that viewer at home may want to go pick up a copy.
Well, if you want to be enriched and empowered to do everything that God's called you to, no matter what your title is or isn't, you may have a pedigree, I don't have a pedigree. I have the school of hard knocks, but I worked hard throughout my life. No matter what your background is, God has a plan to unleash you, the Holy Spirit through you, and anoint you. We talk about what the word anointing means. It means to lather with oil on the sheep, because the number one thing that killed sheep was lice and insects.
Mm-hmm.
What kills us today are the voices of opposition, inferiority, shame. If you've got voices in your head and you think, I just don't have a story. I'm just not smart enough. I'm not pretty enough, or I'm not white enough, or I'm not black enough, or whatever your excuse might be, like the guy at the pool of Bethesda, God has a plan and a purpose to use you right where you are, unleash you, and anoint you for kingdom business. So when that oil went over those sheep, it kept those lice from getting in the ears. That's what the Word of God, the anointing of the Word, when we understand the Word of God, I show people how to pray in this book, how to lay hands on the sick, how to cast out demons, all those things that we're supposed to do.
Yes.
These signs and wonders will follow them that believe. It's a how-to book, how to live out your faith in the marketplace.
Staci, we thank you for coming all the way from Texas today.
Yes.
And of course, we know that you have lived in Georgia. So, you know, we're going to credit that to you. You know, we know you're chosen because you've been here. We appreciate you being here.
Yes.
And we plan on reading the book ourselves.
Yes.
Thank you so much. And we just wish the best for your ministry. Keep on keeping on.
Thank you.
And we're going to support you the best we can.
People can go to Amazon to get that. They can go to the website to get that. And they can also sign up for our course on how to be taught how to do marketplace ministry.
Amen.
Awesome.
Special thanks tonight to Staci Wallace for being with us. Now we're going to turn it back over to Eternal Vision. They're going to sing the song entitled, Free.